afternoon. I'm a bit overwhelmed by the last two speakers, to be very honest, because, I mean, somewhere along the line, we are also into conservation after trying to sell everybody soap. And we ran an NGO for the oceans, and it's called Reforge. And after trying very hard for many years to convince adults about how precious and important the oceans were, and that the tigers of the oceans were the sharks, and that we should protect them, we gave up on the adults, and now we concentrate only on children, because they actually retain what we say, they believe what we say, and they actually practice what we say. And so Reforge has become a very strong educational institution for children about the ocean and the conservation of the ocean, because unlike the forests, you cannot see what you're protecting, because it's just a mass of water and you can't see anything underneath it. So we teach people how to dive, and we take them down, and we realize that the more divers we have, the more people understand what they're protecting about the ocean. Because all the kids today in this country, I think, understand about forests, and they all understand that chipping to a tree is the best way to save it from anybody who wants to actually cut it down, and how it benefits us. But we still have a long way to go when it comes to educating us about the sea, because for one thing, we're frightened of the sea as a country. I don't know why, but we are genuinely frightened of it. It's the greatest sum total of all your fears, because it's the unknown. Because you can't see the bottom, you don't know what it is. It's hugely powerful. And the only motto for the sea is that if you let go of your fears, and you let go of your preconceptions, and you become a part of the ocean, you can be as powerful as the ocean. So, having said that, is this thing working? Yeah. Let me tell you a little bit about my journey into what I do. The fact is that at the time when I was young, they hadn't invented dyslexia. So nobody knew what the hell it was. yes. And so I was a duffer, basically, because I had very selective interests. And I was challenged in terms of the learning process, because I was slower than everybody else in my class. And though I was brilliant in certain subjects like literature, like English, like imagination, like drawing, like outdoors, like sports and all that, I was horrible in physics, chemistry, maths, and everything else that made life possible. So I learned how to switch off in class and go somewhere else while physically being there. So like all of us, I think all of us were challenged in some way, and we can't cope sometimes with everybody else who's brighter, faster, and competitive. And then you turn around and say, the hell with it, yeah, it's not interesting anyway. And then you switch off, and then you, in your mind, you travel to another place, another time, another dimension, and you become a knight in shining armor, and you rescue beautiful women from dragons, and you fight with all the bad guys and win most of the time. So I had a world of my own which I could actually disappear into. And before I learned how to do that, I used to be daydreaming and looking out of the window, and I was punished for that. And the teachers say, you're not paying attention, stand with the dunce's cap, sit in the corner, put your finger on your lip, all this sort of thing, you know. So after a while I got used to it, but then I realized that survival was very important, that I shouldn't be singled out for attention in this slightly humiliating manner. So I learned to pretend to pay attention while I was daydreaming. And that ability till today has saved me from so many situations. You have no idea, you know. So I nod at the right times, I smile at the right times, I look serious at the right times,
and I'm not there. I'm far away. You know? And the last time I actually experienced that was when I heard Hariprasad Chaurasia playing the flute, and he was playing a raga, and he went into this extempo sort of exercise, and he went away. And he, in his mind, he was on the mountains, there were snow caps, he was going over forests, there were rivers, there were fields, and he was far away, and he was playing so brilliantly, and he caught all of us in that trap, that imagination, and took us with him, you know, to his journey through his music. And suddenly he came back to the raga and he looked at all of us and said, what the hell am I doing here? I was somewhere else. And we all looked at him and said, what the hell are we doing here? We were also somewhere else. So it's exactly what a person who is challenged or handicapped in any manner does to keep himself in one piece, which is dream. And the greatest capacity for all of us who are sitting in this room today is the capacity to dream. It's such a powerful single embodiment that we realize that normal people cannot dream at will like we can. We can switch it on and switch it off whenever we want. And normal people who are sort of, you know, okay. They have to go to sleep to dream. And the best part of it is that 90% of them don't remember the dreams. So it's of no point. We remember everything that we dream about because we dream with our eyes wide open. And we dream during the day. And normal people have two kinds of dreams, bad dreams and good dreams. And bad dreams are always the same dream. It's that they're running, and they fall into a gadda. And then they're falling, and just before they hit the bottom, they wake up, sweating. And then they realize that they've overeaten. And that they've eaten stuff that they have not been able to digest. So when they try and sleep, they have these really bad dreams because their stomach is really protesting. You know, all the time. So that's how you get bad dreams, actually. By eating unwisely and too much. You know. So dreaming then became so much a part of my life that I was really lucky when I came to a job that I was given a choice of this, that. Everybody wanted me to join a bank, or they wanted me to join IAS or become an engineer or some rubbish like that. I took one look at the syllabus. I took one look at the number of books, and they went from year to year. And I said, I would rather read porn. So I just refused to read the syllabus. And I decided that I would get whatever job I could. And I had lots of choices. I could become a conservationist. I could become an environmentalist. I could become a forest officer. I could become a tea planter. I could become a horse breeder. Because all these were my interests. And all through my life, I used to dream about these things. So I said, no, I don't want to do these conventional jobs. Everybody is very upset in the family. But they finally realized that I would do what I wanted to do. And when I joined advertising by mistake, it was purely because the receptionist at the office that I went looking for a job in had the best pair of legs I've ever seen. I had no clue about advertising. But advertising had no clue about me either. And they didn't realize at that time, at my time, that the best advertising professionals are dreamers, are professional dreamers. That means 50% of this room today would make great advertising professionals. Because dreaming is all about storytelling. Dreaming is all about stories. We grow up on stories. The world lives, is inspired, is entertained by stories. Every time a child goes to sleep, he says, Mummy, mujhe ek kahani sunao. And she has to then concoct stories. So she has to become a dreamer herself, because she can't tell the same story again and again, even if she's telling Panchatantra, and she has 5 million stories in Panchatantra. But she has to think of stories which are relevant and which the kid can identify with. So the mother becomes a dreamer. And it's a hugely creative process. None of us realize that the business of dreaming is the most creative process you can possibly imagine. So you can become writers for films, you can write stories, you can make movies, you can write theater, you can sit, stand, and narrate them. You know, the oldest form of storytelling is you light a bonfire and all the village children sit around you and you play the Ramayana. So you are Ram, you are Lakshman, you are Sita, and you are Ravan. And it's one person playing every single character and holding these kids spellbound with the magic of storytelling. And they believe that you are Sita. They believe that you are Ravan. They believe that you are Ram. There is no dichotomy there. There is no problem with credibility. If the actor and the storyteller believes that he is who he is, he can become whatever he wants. Look at the power of that. That all storytellers and dreamers can be whoever they want to be for the moment they want to be that. It's like a transformation. It's like you can be a demon, you can be a god, you can be a beautiful woman, you can be anything you want to be. And that breaks every single shackle and boundaries that normal human beings set for themselves. So just remember one thing, that, I mean, whether the world believes in you guys or not, I do, because I realize that you have broken the boundaries what shackle you by normal society. Because when you're on your own and you don't need anybody else for this, you don't need a TV, you don't need a radio, you don't need a screen, you don't need anything, you just need your mind. Because you can sit in a place and you can become whoever you want to become for that moment. It is the greatest pleasure you can either get or communicate to somebody, if you can communicate with them, with the community. Because you can tell them stories which they've never heard of before. Because they're your stories. You've lived them in your mind. When somebody's telling physics and you're living these beautiful stories. Somebody's teaching you chemistry and you're living these beautiful stories. And then you start telling them. So, when I was young, I was punished for daydreaming. Because I couldn't cope with my studies. And now I'm paid obscene amounts of money to do precisely that. So, it's an irony. And because of Farida Pandey's legs, I found my medium. You know? And she actually turned around and said, wow, if the receptionist has such great legs, I wonder what the rest of the office has. So I said, no, I'm going to join this office. So I made the attempt and I convinced the boss. First, I convinced Farida that she would tell the boss that I was a good guy. And since she was his pet, I don't doubt that at all. And she turned around and made the right noises to him. He actually hired me at a very low salary, but compared to the bank. But I left the job of this bank with such alacrity and pleasure and went into the world of storytelling and dreaming. And I've never, ever looked back since. But the beautiful part of it is that because dreaming was so easy for me, I had lots of time on my hands to do other things. So everything that I wanted to do when I was a kid, which I had an option for to be a professional, I did. I became a scuba diver, I became a polo player, I lived on a farm, I learned about wildlife, I studied wildlife, I studied marine life, I studied everything, but without studying. So whatever interested me was not studying, because that was what interested me, so I learned about it. Whatever didn't interest me, I just forgot about. And when I was 40 years old and I went for my diving exam, guess what they put in front of me? A physics paper. And I'd failed in physics when I was 14. And I'd never seen it again. And at 40, I had to look at Archimedes' principle, Boyle's law, Yevo and all that. But because I was so passionate about diving, that physics started making sense to me, because what we learned in the morning, we practiced in the afternoon. Because we went into the water, our practicals were the theory. So suddenly, physics became easy for me because I was practicing the laws and they were affecting my body and the pressure and the water and the buoyancy and, you know, and the freedom of the ocean. And it just changed my life. And I came to terms with physics, but never chemistry or maths for that matter. Because of my dyslexia, I can't count after 3 zeros. So when I went to Vietnam, and it was 10,000 dong for the dollar, and every time you changed $100, you got a couple of million dong, which you had to carry in a suitcase. And I couldn't figure out what the denomination was because there were so many zeros. I used to be totally dependent on the taxi driver or the shopkeeper to give me back the right change. I used to just take a note and give it to him and say, is that okay? Now, where's my change? You know, so then they would give me change. So I've always had this problem. But luckily, I didn't have the problem of left and right. Because I was in a military school, so I knew what by the left was and di mode and by mode. I managed to get that right. You know? But I always dreamt my way through. Now, I believe that somewhere along the line, all the attempts to integrate all the special people in this room into mainstream society is a load of bullshit. Because why are they trying to make people with special abilities into normal people? You know, the only, what do you call, organization that I know, for whatever reason that they do it, recognize special people. It's because when God takes away some part of your physicality, he puts in something extra. So if you're blind, you have a great sense of hearing and touch. And everybody who's slightly handicapped in some way and is challenged, his mind is twice as big as anybody else's because their mind works all the time in whatever way you can to find solutions on how you can cope. Now, because you all have minds which are so much larger and more fertile and more imaginative and essentially your dreaming variety, you all are all psychic. Now, the point is that a lot of us actually don't realize that we're psychic. It takes a special kind of test and a special kind of finding to find you to be extra perception. That extra perception of being psychic is a very, very powerful tool. You're paranormal, abnormal, or rather para-abnormal. Because you can see, hear, imagine, and anticipate things which normal people cannot do. Okay, the Mossad. You know who the Mossad is? The Israeli Secret Service. Finds people like you all and trains them to be psychic, to break codes, to figure out about murders and about terrorism, to find out things through sheer brain power and sensibility to be able to travel astrally. You know what Kundalini travel is? In our yogic sciences, when all your chakras in your body open up through meditation and imagination, then your Kundalini comes alive from the base of your spine. And you can then leave your body and your mind can travel freely across the world and see and experience things and come back to your body. And nobody will know the better. So sometimes you have deja vu, like I have deja vu. You know, I go to a foreign country and I go to a marketplace and I suddenly see that I know this place. I know behind that is a clock tower. an old watchmaker, there's a fruit seller, and I can recognize them. And I say, how can I know? I've never been here in my life. And I realized that it's called, in English, it's called deja vu, because they don't know about Kundalini travel. And that, I know that somewhere in my sleep, I've aroused my, opened my chakras, and I've traveled, and I've been here before. And that's why when I go back there, I can recognize it. That's the only way I can figure it out. But I think I'm dreaming, but I'm not. I'm actually physically there. It's so vivid. It's so lucid that you can make out detail. That's the kind of memory that we all have. So the Mossad trains people who eventually end up with such powerful minds that they can bend spoons at 20 meters. They can bend a spoon with a mind. They can lift things. But they use them for all kinds of other things. For Detective Giri to find out through extra perceptive senses that who murdered who, how did that happen, what were the auras, and they read auras. So I think that we as a society should be looking at all of us as specially gifted people because we can do things which other people cannot do. So why are we trying to make us do what everybody else does badly? So integrating us into a flawed society is actually not the solution. It's to find your strengths, is to find what your capabilities and your special abilities are, hone them, practice them, and then you're invincible. Then you can wear your underwear outside your trousers because you're Superman. So, now that you're out of time, and I'm going to leave you with this thought. Don't try and be normal. You're not. You're special. And don't ever let a company out of charity create space for you so that you can sit with the rest of them and do whatever shit that the rest of them are doing. Because you all are meant for special things. You just have to recognize that. So we need to set up institutions which can actually take individuals and say, what are their strengths? What's so special about them? Are they dreamers? Are they storytellers? Are they psychic? Are they supernatural? What are they? Can they Kundalini travel? Are they yogics? Or what are they? Because I don't think anybody has ever found out except the word challenged. They've never really bothered to find out that all of you are so special and unique in each of your ways because if God has given you some kind of disability, He has also given you a special gift. Every one of us.
This is a Cadbury ad that was made 20 years ago and advertising shelf life is only 6 months
because I've collected a reel of ads that are from different people who I find special because they're timeless. And why I think this is timeless is because it's very special for women. And 20 years ago, when the client looked at this ad, because Piyush Pandey was then a lowly copywriter, and he was trying to sell this to his Cadbury's client, they said, what do you know about Cadbury's? You are not even English speaking properly. You're a Hindi dreaming person. So he says, you want to sell Cadbury's in India? You cannot call it chocolate. You have to call it chocolate. And if it is not chocolate, then if you want to know, if you want to do research as to how much chocolate you're selling, you are selling exactly that much, that chocolate that is in your Diwali hamper. When you get a Diwali hamper, usme mithai kitni hai, laddu kitne hai, you know, Cadbury's kitna hai. You'll get one Cadbury, mushkil se, at that time, 20 years ago. Says, if you let me do this, and if you let me change the mindset of especially the women in this country, to whatever reason it is, 50% of your hamper will be Cadbury's 10 years from now. And that's exactly what happened with this film. So I'm going to just show you that one film to find out 20 years ago how this man, Piyush Pandey, actually thought that he would make a film of this kind which everybody looked at and said, ye to behuda hai. Have a look at it.
खास है हम सभी में कुछ प
डेरी में असली स्वाद जिंदगी का।
20 years ago, every woman in the room said, "I want to be that woman. I am that woman inside me, but I never had the guts to do that." Thank you.
कुछ खास है हम सभी में, कुछ बात है हम सभी में, बात है खास है, कुछ स्वाद है।